Screen Test, There Is Business, and Tomorrow's World. That's just some of the programmes in which you may have seen our special guest today, Michael Rodd. First, let me start by asking you, when did you first decide that you wanted to work in television?
Mike, I don't think anybody can ever be absolutely certain when they took the decision which committed themselves to a career of one sort or another. I went to university because it was obvious that an opportunity was open to me. Mm. I did law because it seemed to be a thoroughly respectable profession. I was surrounded by people who were making pots of money as lawyers, and being as materialistic as possible, I thought this must be a pretty pleasant way of earning a living. You become a pillar of society, you've got a definable career pattern. If you get into the right practice, the sky is the limit. Mm. I reckon halfway through the course, I came to the conclusion that I wasn't going to do a lot of justice to the law, and the law certainly wasn't going to do much justice to me. Mm. At that time, I mean, that's a very naive point of view looking at the situation now, but at that time, it seemed to me that to be a solicitor, you spent half your time divorcing people, 25% of your time writing wills, and as much time as you could spare out of the rest of your life conveying houses, which didn't seem to me to be too demanding. Now, I realize now that if I had become an authority on patent law, on copyright law, on show business contract law, I could have made a fortune. But I didn't. So I had to analyze what I was going to do. And I came to the conclusion that, being honest, I really wasn't very good at anything. But I was quite good at most things. What did that qualify me to do? To be a journalist. Journalists are forever worrying about what everybody else is up to, frightened that they're missing an opportunity in a different field. So it seemed to be the ideal opportunity for me. Having made that decision, I then had to decide whether I was going to work in written journalism or broadcast journalism. And at that time, back shortly after Harold lost the Battle of Hastings, television stations were opening at an exciting rate. BBC mm. Two was on the air, commercial television was established, new opportunities were presenting themselves, independent radio was around the corner, local radio was being talked about. Broadcasting seemed to be the area I ought to be in, whereas written journalism, the newspaper industry at that time, was going through a bad patch. Mm. Mm. The choice was made for me.
Did you ever do anything at school which prepared you for working in television?
Going back, I realized now that I was doing what I was going to be doing for a career. I was responsible for launching a newspaper at middle school. I was editor of a magazine at college. And then when I finally got to university to do law, I was the news editor of the university newspaper in Newcastle. So yes, I was working as a journalist. You see, I was forever sticking my nose into what other people were up to, though I was obtuse enough not to realise that that's really what I ought to be doing for a living.
Mm. So you, a journalist, you, I mean, you did things like, you worked for Border Television and things like Look North, and you also did news.
What do you mean, things like Look
things
North?
Well, there isn't anything like
there's anybody. North. There's nothing like Look North. No, yes. Anybody looking from Newcastle will know that there is nothing like Look North. What a pedigree to have behind one.
Yeah, and News at 10. What do you do at News at 10?
Oh, and well, yes, that's true. That's true. Yes, I have actually worked for News at 10. That predates almost all the things you were talking about. Mm. When I finished at university, and I did actually finish the course. I didn't cop out completely. Ended up with Hons as well. Mm. So I didn't leave the law totally behind. I went to every television station in the country and said, here I am, I'm the answer to all your problems, give me a job. And of course none of them wanted to know. However, Border, for whom I will have lifelong respect and gratitude, said, well, we get ourselves into a bit of a predicament in the summer. We lose 20% of our effort in the newsroom. And I said, they all must go away. No, he said, what it means is one of them goes on holiday for a fortnight. So for a fortnight, we're always short of a little effort. If you'd like to come and work for us, we can give you a contract for a fortnight. So I took the job. Wonderful. It was the only opportunity I had. In I went, and at the end of the first week, somebody turned up to be interviewed who everybody had forgotten about. This guest was summoned from Manchester. His train fare, I suspect, was the entire budget for the week's programme, because we used to make the programme on about 30 quid a week. He came up and presented himself for an interview, and all the accredited performers, I mean, you can always tell the performer because he's got the suit on, you know, you're better dressed than the other lads around here. All the accredited performers were out of the building. They were away on other assignments. And this chap said, well, I can only stay an hour, and then I've got to go. He was from the National House Builders Registration Council. I will never forget that. And the news editor said to the deputy, "We are in shtuck. We've got this guy. We've paid for him. We've got to interview him. How do we get out of the dilemma?" And somebody, I don't know who, suggested that Rod might be the answer. Because if he's no good, he's going at the end of next week anyway.
Yes.
If he's good, we've discovered him. And either way, it gets us off the hook. Yes. So Rod went in and did the interview, and from there on had to include doing occasional interviews with sweeping the floor, doing the news accumulation, the checking of the papers. That's how I wormed my way in, I'm afraid.
So the first interview was a success. I just wonder what would have happened
think it was an absolute disaster.
Well, but anyway, can't have been that.
Well, you see, but you know the truth, don't you? you can flannel your way through a situation, and everybody watching outside thinks, "Isn't he doing well? Excellent." Whereas perhaps deep down in your heart, you think, "Made a complete cock-up of that." Yeah. But never mind. The impression was good enough to let them give me another chance.
So, basically, you're a journalist, then. So
that's right. Why? You asked about news at 10.
Yeah.
That was where that connection came in. I was fortunate enough, and I mean that's the wrong. That's the wrong way to describe it. I was in the right place at the right time when Donald Campbell made his final attempt on the world water speed record on Coniston in 67. It was in Borders area, and because I was the youngest man on the team, I got the job of camping out on the lakeside and following the proceedings.
Yes.
And I was in the position of having the last interview that Campbell ever gave before one morning, much to everybody's surprise, he bit the bullet, got in this boat, charged off down the lake, came back too quickly, and was killed in the ensuing accident. So all of a sudden, Rod became something of a brief national hero. He was the man on the spot at the time with the story, and that was how I started to make regular contributions to News at 10. I say regular, about once every 2 months. If ever there was a story that needed to be covered in the northwest of England or the south of Scotland, News at 10 tended to remember the man who brought them the Donald Campbell story.
So what did you do next? Did you do screen test first?
Screen test.
You remember you're
screen
younger
test.
Than you look.
Oh yes, I remember screen test. I do.
Yeah. Dear me. Yes, I used to get 10 letters from people saying, "Aren't you wonderful with the kids?" And 10 letters from people saying, "Why do you behave like a schoolmaster?" Screen test was a great experience. I left Border in the end of 67, because the BBC, who had, whilst I was making my post-university trek around the country, had said, "Get some experience and we'll come back." And anybody who's in that position now or is going to be in that position will feel just as frustrated as I did. How on earth do you get experience in a job when they won't give you the job with which you can get experience? However, in my case, it worked out. I was able to go back to them and they said, "Now you appear to be showing a bit of promise. We'll give you some work." So I started working for the BBC in Newcastle on Look North, subsequently on Nationwide. And about that time, I met a producer in Manchester called John Buttery, who was, still is, the BBC's authority on the cinema. He and I got talking, and we found that we both had, he had a very expert interest, I had an amateur interest in the movie business. And we came to the conclusion that we really ought to do something to try and put back into the film industry a little of what television had taken away. In other words, try and rekindle the interests of young people in the film business. And we devised this game, which was really based on the thing you may have played if you were ever a Boy Scout, where they show you a tray with 14 objects on, then take it away and you've got to remember what the 14 objects were. Exactly the same idea. Take clips from classic or current examples of the work of the film industry, show them to young people and get them to talk about them. The most important aspect of the program, and I'm being serious about this, we fought a long battle over it, subsequently lost, but that's another story. The most serious aspect of the program was a bit in the middle, which ran about 6 or 7 minutes, which was a report on what was happening in the cinema industry in that month. Yeah. So we looked at the work of lighting men, we looked at the work of cameramen, of actors, of directors, an attempt to get young people to say, "Now there's an industry I had no idea how it worked. I can at least consider whether I would like to be part of it when I come to make a career choice." In the end, the game was so successful that the BBC, and one can understand why, said, what on earth are we doing spending thousands a month getting these reports in just to puff up the film industry when everybody switches on just to play the game?
Yeah.
We play the game. So the bit in the middle got dropped in the last three series. Well, I said the last three series that I did, because, of course, the programme continues to go on from strength to strength. But I introduced Screen Test for 10 years, and I must say it was very therapeutic. I thoroughly enjoyed getting away from London, up to Manchester, meeting a completely different production team, dealing with 12 highly intelligent youngsters who were very interested in what was going on in the television industry, keen to play the game, and completely forgetting about the problems that were developing in London with Tomorrow's World and the other things that I was involved in. I, in the end, had to stop because more and more was going on in London. Mm. And rather than getting away from everything in Manchester where we shot Screen Test, I was finding no sooner did I get there than the telephone would go and somebody would say, we've got a big problem with the catalytic cracker for Thursday's programme. You'll have to give some thought to it. Mm. And I thought the day will come when one of the contestants in Screen Test will not get a fair deal because the chairman's not concentrating on what he's doing.
Mm.
And I don't know if you've ever been in this position as a presenter, but it is a tremendous responsibility when you have got a competitive situation, four people desperate to win, and all of them trying to beat the system and avoid the rules.
Yes.
And you've got to watch all the time what's happening, check the scores are right, because there's no going back, you can only do it once.
Mm.
And I thought the day will come when I'm just so concerned about what's going on in London that I'm not concentrating on what is in danger of becoming a routine operation. So very sadly, I had to say to John, the producer, that at the end of 10 years, I'd have to abandon Screen Test. Happily, it continues. I don't think the audience is quite as big.
No, I'm sure it isn't.
Well, you and I don't watch it anymore.
That's
anyway.
Right. So, Tomorrow's World is that consuming? You have to spend all your time worrying about it.
It used to be. I joined Tomorrow's World in 70. And though I know that people say, why did they employ somebody who had not got an ounce of science in him?
Mm.
I think, said he modestly, they employed the right sort of guy. I'm not saying they employed the right example, but they looked in the right area. Because Tomorrow's World, if it is anything at all, is a layman's introduction to a number of very complex subjects. It cannot ever be everything you need to know about neurosurgery or digital recording techniques or computer analysis, but it is at least an introduction to a number of sophisticated subjects each week. And I can get into them just as the viewer can and bring my what journalistic skills I've got and reflect the enthusiasm that I've picked up from the people who've spent years working on the subject. I can reflect that, hopefully, across the screen to everybody else so that maybe the next time you're in the dentist's waiting room and you see a magazine on the table which is Engineering Today or Practical Computing, you don't necessarily move on to Over 21 or Honey. You actually pick up the engineering magazine because something that we did on the program just reminds you that it is an interesting subject, that the areas are not closed to those who are not engineers.
Yeah. Do you feel you're sometimes running a recruiting service for a place like Imperial, that at the age of about 8, when people watch your program, they're fooled into thinking that engineering is interesting, and then by the time they get to 17 and they have to decide which university they're going to, they decide to go for engineering?
Well, as a non-scientist, I'd never say that science wasn't interesting. Do you feel that science isn't interesting?
Well, the problem is, I used to watch Tomorrow's World, of course, when I was at school and was fooled into thinking that science is interesting. You come to a place like this and you realise that you don't spend the whole time doing interesting things. You go into things in far more detail.
Yeah, but come on, Mike, that's the same with everybody's life, isn't it?
I mean,
people look at me and say, oh, Michael Rod, you lucky beggar. Half an hour a week, and that's all you do. Must be better than having a job. And here I am, working hard with you. You see, they don't realise all these things that go on, the background work. Mm. I'd find it very difficult to defend in front of an engineer or a scientist the view that we shouldn't be making science as interesting as it possibly can be. I think that we have a role to play in at least presenting the possibilities that exist. Maybe 8's a little bit early, but if they watch at 8, well, who knows. So that by the time for a, when the time for a choice does come, at least as many possibilities as we can have got across will have been presented on television. And I think television has a great responsibility to open, it was James Burke who said it, open trap doors in people's minds so that they are aware of experiences and possibilities that they wouldn't otherwise have known existed. In that way, I think Tomorrow's World presents a valuable role.
Before we go any further, Mike, let's look at a clip from you in action on Tomorrow's World.
Matter, of course, is made of atoms. And atoms, in their turn, are made of positively charged protons, negatively charged much smaller electrons, and neutrons. Now, our story tonight centres on protons and electrons. Very, very occasionally, scientists have discovered antiprotons and anti-electrons, antimatter, which has the same weight, mass, as ordinary matter, but which carries a different electrical charge. Now, should any particle ever meet its antiparticle, their combined mass, all the material in both, disappears in a flash of pure energy. Indeed, if I were unfortunate enough to meet someone made of antimatter, then Rod and Anti-Rod, previously thought to be made of solid material, would disappear with enough energy to blow up the British Isles.
Tomorrow's World is quite a unique programme, isn't it? There's nothing to compare with it, even on ITV.
It's always amazed me that ITV has not challenged Tomorrow's World on its own ground. And indeed, if that's what you want to get onto, that is what I am currently involved in.
With TV South.
Exactly, exactly. You have suggested, as politely as one would expect from somebody of your position, that not all is perfect with Tomorrow's World. The programme has been running 18 years, and I think there are many people who would say it's a great show, but it has its shortcomings. Now, within an organisation like the BBC, there have been countless battles to develop, to change, to take this great strength, which I think we've got, and turn it into something slightly more than the ragbaggy magazine approach, perhaps, as you suggest, over-glamorising science occasionally, and bring it up to the 1980s rather than the 1970s, into which it fitted absolutely admirably. The trouble is, the BBC have got a great success on their hands. On a Thursday night, a nucleus of people watch nationwide, 2 million more watch Tomorrow's World, 3 million more watch Top of the Pops. By the time that funny Irishman comes on at 8 o'clock with Blankety Blank, they're having a bonanza.
Yes.
People are very reluctant to tinker with the basic format of Tomorrow's World. Mm. So after 10 years, you see, 10 years a kind of cataclysmic time in my life. After 10 years of working on Tomorrow's World, I feel the programme needs a change and I need a change, and the opportunity to develop a popular technology-orientated programme for the other side presented itself. So rightly or wrongly, I've taken it. Well, within 6 months, we'll know whether it was rightly or wrongly.
So you're not happy with doing programmes like The Risk Business, which I think I once described to someone as being an adult's version of Tomorrow's World, rather unfairly, I think.
You see, the Risk Business, and the BBC took the decision that the output of the Risk Business would be amalgamated into programmes like the Money Programme and Current Affairs programmes. We maintained that Tomorrow's World was fine as far as it went, as far as it goes. Let's not talk about it as if it was a thing of the past. But that there were questions raised by all sorts of the items that we did. Yeah. Why does Imperial College follow a particular line? Why does industry choose to support that line of research? What are the decisions that have to be taken as you go through a development program, whether you continue it or you abandon it? How do you turn the possibilities of the academic research desk into the realities of the marketplace? That's what the Risk Business was trying to do. It was trying to say, this is how money is raised for particular products, particular developments. This is how decisions are taken. These are the possibilities that exist to business and industry. Mm. How would you, Mr. Viewer, like to have to make that decision?
So do you think programmes like Tomorrow's World and The Risk Business are providing a public service in informing people about science rather than just entertaining people?
Yes, I hope they are. I mean, I hope principally that they entertain, because if they don't, people won't watch. The important thing is to get people to watch. If they are at the same time just opening a few of those James Burke trapdoors, then I'll be very happy.
Do people stop you in the street and ask you to explain scientific principles to them?
It has happened on a few occasions. I have the sort of mug that people don't instantly latch onto. It's infuriating. Someone said, what happens when someone asks you for your autograph? I said, oh, it's annoying if it's more than half a dozen. And they said, what happens if they don't? I said, it's annoying. You see, you can't win. Yes, people do certainly strike up conversations as if they knew you. Mm. Often there's 3 or 4 minutes in which they circle round the subject to try and find out if it really is you or not. But once they've locked in, bang! Yes. Now, that epoxy resin bonding you were talking about. Absolute nonsense. Did it really hold up the elephant in the studio? Yes, quite often.
And what do you say?
We never do anything on Tomorrow's World that isn't honest. If I remember reading in New Scientist, not the greatest fan of Tomorrow's World, that television was in danger of fudging issues, of presenting demonstrations which were weighted in favour of television and showbiz rather than scientific honesty. The Tomorrow's World team responded to that with a letter which New Scientist published, making it absolutely clear that we had never been party to a demonstration in the studio which was a dishonest representation of what was going on. If the matchstick held the elephant thanks to the epoxy resin bonding, then that was an absolutely straight up demonstration. Occasionally we have to edit something to get it into the 24-27 time slot that the program has to fill, but I have certainly never been party to, and I cannot think of an example, because it is something, I mean, in this happy-go-lucky showbiz world in which we live, it is something we take very seriously. I cannot think of an example where we have demonstrated something which was not the case. And indeed, we've been in situations where things have gone wrong.
And that's
the price you pay. I mean, if you want to be honest, occasionally technology will let you down.
Yeah, it must be very worrying doing a live program. I was thinking of things like the launch of the first space shuttle when you were presenting that program, and the launch didn't in fact take place, and you had to pad out the program for half an hour. I mean, you must have been running short of things to say.
It didn't feel desperate to me. I mean, I hope it didn't look desperate to you.
Well, I just realised the position you must be in, because you're expecting something to happen and it hadn't. Obviously prepared for it, because you had films and things to put in.
The thing that did embarrass me about that program was the fact that here were the NASA team about to send men on a technologically miraculous journey, and the BBC, and in the BBC's defense, ITV and everybody else as well, couldn't actually get a telephone call through to Cape Canaveral. I mean, that I found very embarrassing. That did worry me no end, that we'd got old Kieran the Prendeville out there, and we couldn't reach him. Couldn't actually make a 10p telephone call. Whereas we were trying to cover technology which would long since have passed those problems by.
Yeah, that rather nicely leads me on to the question that I did want to ask anyway, and the one that everyone wants to know the answer to. Why is it that on Tomorrow's World you always look so smart, and Kieran Prendeville always looks so scruffy?
Well, he was born in Rochdale.
Ah, right, okay. Oh, dear. I hope everyone's satisfied with that answer.
You look very smart yourself.
Oh, thank you so much.
But can I, what's the date today? Well, yes, I should think you could have Kieran in next week, couple of weeks, and say, I'll ask Michael Rod and got a totally unsatisfactory answer. No, I think he has shares in Burton.
Ah, yes, I see. Yes.
Perhaps he meant Burton the brewer, not Burton the tailor.
Okay, Michael Rod, thank you very much indeed.
Mike Hackett, many thanks to you.